So today I am standing on top of a hill in an abandoned phosphate mine at my good friend Don's property in Central Florida. And we are here to answer one fundamental question today. Are megalodon teeth radioactive? The reason I thought to put together this video is I was reading a bunch of articles. Yeah, I mean a bunch of articles on how homeowners were suing phosphate corporations because they were worried that undisclosed radiation might be affecting their health. There were studies about how phosphate workers were more prone to morbidity. And so today we're going to be looking at some of my fossils that I have from this area. I thought I have the perfect test source. Plus, I was honestly just curious to see if my megalodon teeth were radioactive. So we have right here a CDV-700. It was built by the Civil Defense Force in 1967 during the height of the Cold War era. And we've got fossils from Central Florida, right where these mines are that the articles you saw popped up were referencing. We've got uranium ore, megalodon teeth from Georgia, some mammal fossils, some terrestrial fossils for comparison, a big 6-inch tooth from North Carolina, and then for diversity's sake, a megalodon tooth from Indonesia. So let's get right down to it. Now, this Geiger counter measures beta and gamma radiation. And so for those of you that kind of fell asleep during science class, we will do a quick little lesson overview. And if you don't want to watch that, you can catch back up to the measurements of these fossils at the, I'm not sure what it is now, but at this mark. So let's get to it. Now, simply speaking, radiation is just a way in which the unstable atoms of elements can become stable. Some atoms have an unhealthy combination of electrons, protons, and neutrons, and radioactivity is a way for these atoms to balance themselves and reach a stable state. Now, there are three different forms of radiation: alpha radiation, beta radiation, and gamma radiation. Alpha radiation is the weakest form of radiation and occurs in the form of two protons and two neutrons emitted from an unstable atom. It cannot penetrate paper. Beta radiation, on the other hand, is more penetrative and occurs in the form of an electron emitted from an unstable atom. It can penetrate through paper, but cannot penetrate through aluminum. Finally, gamma radiation is the most penetrative form of radiation, able to penetrate through paper and aluminum, but not through lead, and occurs in the form of electromagnetic radiation from an unstable atom. And electromagnetic radiation is, you could think of it as scary light energy. In the following example of a uranium decay chain, you can see how uranium uses multiple forms of radiation to eventually get to the stable form of lead, which has a happy balance of electrons, protons, and neutrons. Now, to summarize, there are three forms of radiation: alpha, beta, and gamma. And radiation, in its most simplest terms, is a way for an unstable atom to become stable. Now, who's ready to test some megalodon teeth? All right, first things first, let's open the sensor. Let's see it click. And let's turn it on. Right now, the sensor should be picking up any background radiation. So any clicks or counts you see right here, there's one right there, is from radon in the soil. And so right now I've got it set to measure counts per minute, and it's at 1 times. So if it says 100, it's 100 counts per minute. We might have to move it up times 10 if anything's, you know, crazy. Here are our first set of culprits: fossil whale vertebrae and two megalodon teeth found locally. We'll start with that big whale vert. We've got the sensor open. We've got the first whale vert. We've got the phone up here, ready to record some counts. Let's get started. Ooh, it's picking up some radiation, but really not that much. There we go, a few counts. Picking up a little bit of radiation that's passed back around. Let's try the megalodon tooth next. Our first meg tooth that we're testing, put it right up, one count, really not much. Let's try this section of root over here, couple counts. One more meg tooth from here that we're gonna test, put it up, a few counts. So they are radioactive, just slightly though. Let's see how that compares with our Georgia megalodon teeth. Here we are with those Georgia megs. Let's get it rolling. Let's try this beautiful big one first. Put it up. Let's watch to see if the count responds. Oh, yeah, definitely. Ooh! This one is showing to be significantly more radioactive than the other one. You can even see the dial right up here in the corner. That's impressive. Okay, let's try the other one. See, it's coming back down. Let's get it going. This one is radioactive too. So both these are from Georgia, which funny enough is near Kings Bay, where they have the nuclear submarines there. United States nuclear submarines. I think that's just a coincidence, a correlation, not a causation. But these two teeth are definitely radioactive. Let's test that North Carolina meg next. All right, we've got this big honker of a tooth, 6 inches plus. Let's see if she gives off some counts. Put it up. Definitely getting some counts. It seems to be kind of in between the Georgia stuff and the Central Florida stuff. There we go. That's definitely radioactive. Now don't worry, it is not high enough of a radiation to be harmful to me, but it is still significant. Well, I guess we've already answered the question if megalodon teeth are radioactive, but it's really interesting to see that these do differ based off of locality. Let me get the last megalodon tooth, the one we've got from Indonesia. All right, here we go. Back with the Indonesian megalodon tooth. So, quite a bit away from where we are now. Let's see if an ocean or two away makes a difference. Okay, the sensor's on it, but it's not picking up anything. These single counts you see right there might just be background radiation, the radon that's in the soil. Let's try over here in the front. Nothing. It is less radioactive. Basically, it's not radioactive at all. So this tooth has no signs of secondary radiation. We can't tell if it's higher than background radiation. That is interesting. We'll have to talk about that in the discussion. Let's do, for comparison, the mammal stuff, the terrestrial fossils next. So we've got four mammal fossil here. One giant ground sloth claw that I found locally from the genus Paramylodon. A giant ground sloth claw from the cave systems in Bolivia. A gomphothere tooth from the Miocene, same age as the megalodon shark teeth, that was discovered close to the Georgia megs. So these two are very similar in locality and age. And then a mastodon tooth that I also found locally. So let's start with the local fossils, this giant ground sloth claw. Will it give us any counts? And I'm not seeing anything registered, just a little bit, but no, you can't say that's more than background radiation. Now, let's test the local mastodon tooth. See, that was background radiation, those counts right there. Here's the mastodon tooth. Nothing. Zip. Nada. And the main reason why that is we have 6 gigatons of uranium dissolved in the ocean. At least that's what I heard in college, but it's a lot. And that can replace the calcium in the shark teeth, but will it replace some of the calcium and bone structure in this gomphothere tooth, which is the same age. Let's test it. It's giving off a few counts. It's hard to say if that's more than background radiation, though. I don't think so. And finally, I know that this claw is really interesting because I tested it earlier. Oh, there's a few counts. Here we go. So this ground sloth claw is slightly, very slightly above background radiation. And that might relate to it being found in a cave system. All that dissolved water might have leached radioactive minerals from the surrounding rock and replaced them in this bone. So we've seen a lot of really interesting stuff so far. I am ready to talk about it. All right, there is one more thing I wanted to test today. So this right here is a piece of uranium ore from New Mexico. Let's see if we can't light this Geiger counter up. Oh, that's terrifying. That is terrifying. Let's put this at 10 times. That is still terrifying. It should, okay. So that means it's reading at 1,500 counts a minute right now. I probably should stop. This is getting a little bit dangerous. All right, let's get into the grit of what's going on today. So earlier today, we talked about how there is a lot of radioactive material dissolved in the ocean, and I think that might be the first clue in understanding why these marine fossils were much more radioactive than these terrestrial fossils. So there is about 6 gigatons of uranium dissolved in the ocean, which is a huge number. But that still doesn't explain why an individual tooth like this varied from a tooth like this. So this is a Georgia megalodon tooth, and even though they both came from the ocean, you can tell that there was a very different level of mineralization. This tooth from central Florida is phosphate rich. It was mineralized by an upwelling zone off the coast of Florida during the Miocene. This tooth was in a more deep ocean environment. You can see pyrite minerals that have leached into the burlet and enamel that are more from the host rock of the area. Now, despite that difference, it is still very obvious that these marine fossils are more radioactive than these terrestrial fossils, with the exception of this one sloth claw from Bolivia. Now, this sloth claw was found in the cave system there, and most likely the porous rock in that cave leached some minerals, and those minerals then found their way and remineralized this bone. And so that might explain why this was slightly more radioactive. Let's take this mastodon tooth that was found locally. This was found in a river. The animal died probably in a marsh and got preserved in some kind of peat. And that peat wasn't concentrated in uranium, radium, and other minerals. But that still leaves us with one really weird question, kind of like why we started this video. The articles about homeowners freaking out about these local phosphate rocks. And I personally think that's more post-processing. So when we make this into a product, fertilizer, we have to react it with sulfur. And by doing that, we create a lot of byproducts, one of them being radium. And radium is found in gypsum that they stack in massive, supermassive piles around Tampa Bay. Now, that gypsum was once sold to China as a product and was remade into drywall and sold back to us. When we found out that we were buying radioactive drywall, we ixnayed on that real quick. And now we just have piles of it that we don't know what to do with. But I think what we learned today and what we saw from these fossils was incredible. If you guys enjoyed it, it takes a lot of effort and work to put these videos together. And we really believe with this channel, we can connect these awesome fossils that we find in Florida and Georgia and South Carolina, relevant scientific concepts like deep time, extinction, radioactivity, fluorescence, climate change. So if you guys want me to make more of these videos, please like, share, subscribe, and I promise that we will bring more of this awesome scientific content to you. And really, seriously, thank you so much for watching. It means so much to this channel, what I'm trying to do.